So high. This morning from the strangest dream, I was in the biggest army the world has ever seen. We were marching as one on the road to the Holy Grail. Started out seeking fortune and glory. It's a short song, but it's a hell of a story when you spend your lifetime trying to get your hands on the Holy Grail. But have you heard about the Great Crusade? We ran into millions and nobody got paid. Yeah, we raised four corners of the globe for the Holy Grail.
Continual growth of the strength of club rugby, which is very important, but I've also seen the talent that we can develop locally, and I'm a strong believer in local talent. The Brumbies have given players the pathway to play at the very top level and amongst the top level, but there's also a history of great players that have come through the ACT. Campese and Michael O'Connor are obviously amongst the greats. But if you go through, we've had someone in nearly every position on the field who's come from Canberra, you know, from the Didiers, the Cornishes, and all these guys. And I hate to think that would ever stop.
Well, we've come out of the Kookaburras and the Griffins. It's just a pleasure to see the development of those teams, the teams that have now history, the team, the ACT sides that have beaten Queensland, have beaten New South Wales, have beaten international teams. And you know, we're up in the forefront of historic rugby union now. After 75 years, it's fantastic.
Biggest memory was trying to get a team together. We really struggled to get 20 players. And we finally got 17 players who were available and wanted a tour. So that was a big thing. We were pretty much a hodgepodge side. And no one gave us a chance at all to win. We were just going up in there to give them a practice game. Queensland thought we were a bit of a laughing stock. And if you saw us get off the plane, you could probably take that opinion yourself, because the thing we had in common was a green tie. That's all we had, no uniform. Anyhow, we got on there and we had a pack to really stick it into these Queensland guys. And I think we took them by surprise, the ferocity of the forward pack. The backs had a bit of ball and good two or three tries. I think we scored 2-1. And that was one of the highlights of my career for sure. And then the aftermax function, where there wasn't much socialising from the Queensland side, but we had a good time.
Stuart McDougall really was the one that stood out, that we did have a future. He was an extraordinary leader.
Stuart McDougall, the runt, one of the ACT legends. He's been called the runt because he was the smallest of a huge family. He was, and he played in the front row, Captain Wests, Captain the ACT, and was a famous Wallaby front row player.
Stuart McDougall's, I played with Stuart for many years, and an absolute character. Again, we were fortunate in naming a medal after Stuart. I'd like to repeat some of the things that happened off the field with Stuart, but he was a tremendous performer and leader on the field.
I don't think anyone in ACT had a bigger influence on the competition from Stu, and to our culture and how we play the game. He was a fantastic man.
When I first played for Royals in that for early years, we had a fellow called Michael O'Connor. Some of you may have heard of him. He was a dual international, played for the Wallabies and the Kangaroos. Michael was probably still one of the most wonderful players that I've ever played with. He was something special. I played with him at school as well, and then we went into grade, and he was he just had this, they call it an X factor. I don't know what that really means, but anyway, if I had to describe him, I would say he just had this something special that I'd never seen in any other player. Maybe in Mark Allen.
Someone of note for me was David Campese. He was one of my heroes growing up. Always wanted to be like him.
And then a couple of years later, of course, it was David Campese, and Campo came onto the scene. Campo was something special as well. Campo, I don't know how anyone ever tackled Campo. See, until Campo got the ball, even when he got the ball, Campo didn't know what he was going to do. So if Campo didn't know what he was going to do, how would the opposition know what he was going to do? And that's what he was like. We didn't know what he was going to do, but it was always going to be something special. It was great to play with Campo.
Uh, 1994 was my first year out of school and my first year with the ACT senior side, and it was an incredible side, as you can imagine, coming under the wing of people like Jeff Didier, Paul Cornish, Matt O'Connor. It was a great thrill for me, and we had a huge amount of success to play against Ireland and to beat a national side. was a big thing for ACT Rugby at that stage, and you know, a huge honour, and that started, I think, the development of, or the observation from external people that people from the ACT Rugby team could go on and play for Australia. Obviously Matt O'Connor went on that next week and debuted for the Wallabies, and it started some momentum around ACT Rugby during that period.
In 1994, we had a very, very good ACT side. I was called back in. We were to play New South Wales, and the ACT side, they'd been going along all right. But anyway, a couple of the selectors gave me a call and asked me if I'd consider coming out of retirement and running on against New South Wales. And I ummed and ahed about it, but well, not for very long, I would have to be honest. And the selector said, mate, you'll be up against Tony Daly. And he was the Wallaby prop at the time. I thought, right, I'm doing it. Yes. So we played New South Wales in 1994, and we'd never beaten them. We'd always struggled. We had a very good side. And we had a side, there was about eight or nine who either had played for Australia or were to become Wallabies later on. And the forward pack, Marco Caputo, John Ross, Mark McGuinness, it was a wonderful, wonderful side, really. The back line, George Greig and Matt O'Connor, Rod Kafer, a young fellow named Joe Roth, you may have heard of him as well. That was this new ACT side, which was taking on the might of New South Wales at Concord Oval. And we gave it to them. 5-2. Once again, I haven't looked this up, but I remember it. The fact that I scored the first try is not really that important. But it was 5-2. I think Roffey got a couple. 42-28, I'm pretty sure the score was. And that was set the scene. Well, all of a sudden, we're on the Australian radar now. People are noticing us, really noticing it, not just one-off occasions now, because the ACT side, a little earlier on, I'd beaten Ireland as well. So, you know, this was a good side.
In 1994, when we played New South Wales up at Concord, and I'm sure we were given no chance to win that match. And I remember it being in the halftime huddle and listening to the New South Wales coach roar about how this was not supposed to happen, and that they were supposed to trounce the boys from ACT. And to score 44 points against New South Wales, and we were really very much the little brother at that stage, was a great sign of things to come, and a classic win for the ACT rugby side. And that was back in the day when you had a bus trip back to Canberra. I can assure you it was one of the most enjoyable bus trips back to Canberra that we've had in a long while.
Once we beat them in 94, then we realised why we really did hate them, because they were terrible. They were bad winners, but they were terrible losers, and that made it even more enjoyable. And that rivalry continued on, of course, for the next few years. Now, I saw a report there a few years ago when somebody from the Brumby said, oh, we don't have that absolute hatred anymore. I hope that's not true. I hope we still hate them, because all the old players, we still hate them.
Jeffrey Lawrence did here, well, he's a living legend. The Duke is just a legend. I mean, he was a great player, never took a backward step. Was a very, very good player. And the interesting thing is, had he been playing today, he would have had a hell of a lot of number of test caps. But yeah, he's a wonderful character, extraordinary man, made an incredible contribution to ACT Rugby. He's a bit of a larrikin, as you know. I've probably heard. I'm afraid that I can't tell you a lot of the stories about Jeffrey because they're unprintable, and I wouldn't survive if you found out that I told you, so I better keep my mouth shut.
In 1995, the Kookaburras were in the Sydney competition. That was our ACT team, and we were playing against the Randwicks, against the Eastern Suburbs, and we were quite successful that year, and I think it allowed Canberra and ACT Rugby to set a foundation for establishing a Super 12 side.
And in that first year, we did very, very well. In fact, we made it to the grand final. We played Gordon in the grand final in the first year, and very, very similar side as to the ACT side that had played the season before. Well, they just thought we were a bunch of public servants, I think. But we went up there, and you could edit that out if you like, Angus, but I hope you don't. But we went up there, and we gave it to them, and we were physical, and we had talent, and it was a wonderful time to be involved in ACT rugby. It was very exciting. I still look back, and I still have the fondest memories of those times.
The players came from representatives from every club in Canberra. Every club graciously forwarded their players. They weren't too happy at the start, but when they saw the strength of the club developing, it's a bit like the Brumbies coming back into playing now. And it was just one of the best times for ACT rugby. And to tell you the truth, the Brumbies evolved from that. In the first year, I believe the reserve grade side won the premiership in Sydney. I was lucky enough to have a bit of involvement with that. And our first grade side lost to Gordon in the grand final. And Sydney weren't too happy about that. They were not happy at all, the Canberra team coming in.
So in 1995, the Canberra Kookaburras, we made the grand final. So we shook the rugby world. That grand final was a bit unfortunate. We lost, it was in the wet. I think I may have been sent off in the last few minutes. I was sent off. And not that it had any bearing on the game, but I thought that might just add a little bit of interest to the viewers.
Realistically, if the Kookaburras hadn't have existed and the Brumbies hadn't have been formed in 1996, many of us, the Gregans, Larkhams, would have had to leave Canberra to pursue our rugby careers. So the Kookaburras was fantastic. Disappointing to lose in the grand final of the Sydney competition in that first year. And of course, subsequently, we were kicked out, perhaps for being successful in our first year. I'm not sure why, but it was a great time. And a great lead into professional rugby for some of us who wanted to pursue this as a career.
And then, World of Form, the next season, the Super Rugby was announced, Super 12. And the basis of that Canberra Kookaburra side was to make up the Brumbies side with a few, we call them blow-ins, but really they weren't really blow-ins, they were all nice fellows. And they came down. There was about eight of the guys that came down to bolster the ranks of the ACT stocks, I suppose you could say.
The first Brumby season was just magical. We were written off as having no chance. We were called the bitter and twisted, and we were the discards from all of the other states. And we came together with a point to prove, but without any baggage or any chains to hold us down. We could create our own culture, and we really did. I remember Louis Late from the Transvaal president saying that Transvaal in that first match would beat us by 100 points. And that was the sort of expectation that other teams had of this small side from Canberra joining the Super 12. And so when we went out and we won our first match against Transvaal, it started something that was very special for Canberra.
And in that first year, we were very unlucky not to make the final four. Actually, we only just missed out. But once again, we proved beyond a reasonable doubt that these unknowns were competitive on the world stage, and we were. All of a sudden, we were beating these more fancied sides. It was very exciting times to be involved in, and for me, you know, I got a taste of professional rugby, you know.
We had a fairly successful first year under Rod McQueen. We got close to getting to the playoffs, one position off the playoffs. The following year we got to the grand final, so again, made up of a nucleus of Canberra guys, we had really good success at Super Level.
I was just hugely fortunate to have been in the right place at the right time, to have been part of the formation of that wonderful Brumbies team and the organisation that we now know so well and love so much. The 2001 grand final followed the heartbreak of 2000 when we lost a home grand final. And so the motivation in the team to succeed and to do this for the people and the community that we have had played for and that had supported us so well, it was just through the roof. We really wanted that Super 12 title to be written that Canberra and our team, our local team, had won that. And so it was an incredible match, and I think it was one of the most complete performances that our team's ever played in that, both in the lead up to that final, but to play in front of a packed Bruce Stadium against the Sharks, and to win convincingly was just, it created a party in Canberra that I've never seen before and perhaps never seen since. The grand final was a surreal game, really, for all of us. To be leading against the Crusaders by about 30 points after 20 minutes just made no sense. It was just an incredible atmosphere out there. Every bounce of the ball went our way. George Smith was doing things that were just amazing. Steve Larkin, Mark Gerrard. It was a litany of players who just couldn't do anything wrong on that night. And obviously the Crusaders, such a special team to come back, but we managed to hold them out and create history by being the only Australian side not only to have won it once, but to have won it twice. And really, this is a small town, and no one expected that of us. And so we really created history and created a legacy for Brumbies rugby and ACT rugby that befitted the great history and the tradition and the wonderful players who came through ACT rugby throughout its whole history, but perhaps weren't given the stage in which to perform that we were on that night.
The club rugby in ACT has always been a rather tight-knit sort of a community, really. We've had a wonderful rivalries, and you can go through the clubs and the rivalries we've had with each other. In the 80s, it really was, in the early 80s, it was Wests and Royals, and then and with Queanbeyan, and then the Royals had a wonderful era, so we had rivals with everybody. Everybody hated us, I suppose, so, and then I don't blame them. And with Darren Marlin, they call them, who are they now? The Eagles, are they? I still call them Darren Marlin anyway. So, and all the old Darren guys will like that, I'm sure. But the rivalries were wonderful.
Well, it's a small union. Everybody knows everybody. I know when I still go down and watch club rugby today, I see guys that were either administrating or playing or refereeing 30, 40, 50 years ago. I think people stick by it, so that's one of the great things. It's got some real history about it.
We made the right decision to go our own way, and it's important that people remember that we are an independent group of players, of officials and what have you, and we have earned our right. We always regarded ourselves as the third power, and we've proven that we are.
Compared with 75 years ago when I wasn't around then, but I look at the premises that we're currently in and the premises that we're going to, and the structure that we have in place, I think we've got a tremendous future in ACT, and will be prominent in Australian rugby for a long, long time.
And I said to the boys last year, this club owes me nothing. The joy and the thrill of just being involved in the rugby in Canberra, it's enough. It always was enough, and it still is. It's just great to be a part of it.